Hello friends, welcome to ELS, English Literature Studies with Gaur Harpreet. Today we will discuss about Tess of the D'Urbervilles by Thomas Hardy, right? And in today's topic, that is going to be very interesting, today I will discuss, is Tess a pure woman or not, right? So let's get started. To justify our subtitle, is Tess a pure woman or not? Tess of the D'Urbervilles is regarded as Hardy's tragic masterpiece, subtitled as A Pure Woman. It was first published in 1891 by Thomas Hardy. And it appeared in weekly installments between July and November 1891. It initially appeared in a censored and serialized version published by the British illustrated newspaper The Graphic in 1891. Then in book form in three volumes in 1891 and a single volume in 1892. This is all about Tess of the D'Urbervilles novel. And this novel is now considered as a major 19th century English novel. Even it is also known as Hardy's fictional masterpiece. And this novel received mixed reviews when it first appeared, because it challenged the sexual morals of the Victorian England, right? Now, next is, as per the society of the 19th century, there were two types of women. Here I will discuss two types of women. Why I'm discussing this point? Because our topic is not regarding the story of the Tess of the D'Urbervilles. Our story is related to, is Tess a pure woman or not? And before that, we should be clear in mind, according to that Victorian society, which one is a pure woman and which one is not, right? As per society of the 19th century, there were two types of women. First one is pure woman. When we talk about pure women, it means these were seen as pure and clean, that is virgins until the marriage, right? And the bodies are seen as temples should not be used for pleasure. Their role was in the society, these pure women's role was to have children and take care of the house, right? They were totally pure. And women who did not fulfill these expectations of the society, they were seen as second type of woman or fallen one, right? Now, what about Tess? Victorian society regarded Tess as a fallen woman. She seems to be a victim of circumstances to Thomas Hardy. She seems to Thomas Hardy as a pure woman. On the other hand, there are people of other opinion. According to them, Tess is not a pure woman. She is a fallen woman. These are those who believe that Tess is a fallen woman. They see Tess as a woman who wronged herself in all the rules and laws of the society, and therefore Tess should be punished, right? When we talk about Tess, Tess of the D'Urbervilles is a tragic novel of a young girl named Tess. And Tess, she goes through many struggles in her life, and due to her innocence and youth, ends up violated by one man and forsaken by another one, right? And let me talk about its story in the brief, that it is a story of a country girl who is first presented as an innocent girl, but she turns into tragic heroine. From Thomas Hardy's point of view, Tess is not at all responsible for what she has done. She is a victim of a series of misfortunes which slowly destroy her personality, right? And this novel has 7 chapters, and each chapter represents a phase of Tess' life after which she becomes more mature. She struggles throughout her life. As Thomas Hardy wrote this work in the Victorian age, it becomes obvious that that he was attacking that society through his character, through Tess, right? And he describes Tess experiences of the world, her feelings, and give us an intense reality with the help of this character, right? And Thomas Hardy's novel Tess of the D'Urbervilles begins with the epigraph. What is written there? Poor wounded name my bosom as a bed shall lodge thee. These are the quotes from William Shakespeare, right? The narrow morality which questions Tess' essential purity was very much in evidence in Victorian England. And it is Thomas Hardy who takes pain to establish in the course of the story that Tess is not a fallen woman, she is a pure woman. Some people may ask or may arise on question how test can be considered pure when Thomas Hardy wants to prove her, how we can say that she's a pure, because Thomas Hardy himself calls her a maiden no more, right? Then how she can be pure? In the physical sense, let me clear up that in the physical sense, Tess is no longer a virgin after her experience with the Elekin Wooden. But her spirit, her mind continue to be pure. Still, she is pure, right? Just by these prevailing, we can say prevailing standards, which are prevailing in the society. When the novel was published, Tess was surely guilty, but one of the targets of attack in the novel is precisely on those social conventions, right? According to which Tess' guilt could not be condoned, could not be pardoned. And one of the targets of attack in the novel is precisely on these social conventions embodied in Angel Clare, according to which Tess' guilt could not be condoned, right? And the entire question of Tess' innocence or Tess' guilt is to be decided in the light of her relationship with Alec. What is her relationship, right? And to prove her relationship, there are three outstanding events in her association with Alec, which are: first one is her seduction, second is her eventual surrender, and third is her murder of him. These are the three outstanding events we should keep in mind while deciding her relationship with Alec, right? If anyone who is not acquainted with the story, if there is any person who doesn't know the story, doesn't know the full story, but to be told of these three incidents without any explanation, without any elaboration, he would be shocked at the use of word pure for test. This is the reason that I've told this story in brief, that we should know the story before coming to a judgment, right? And but it is because of circumstances in which these three incidents occur: her seduction, her surrender, and then murder of him. There are some circumstances, and we can say that Tess is a victim of these circumstances, right? And Thomas hardly defends Tess with many arguments in her favor. He also expects from the readers to know her, look at her with sympathy and love. Friends, let me tell you one thing here, that if you want hard copy of these notes, as I'm getting lots of request that you want full-fledged notes, if you want hard copy of these notes, what I'm explaining here, I will give you a link in the description box. You can click on that link and you will get a hard copy, right? So let us continue. Hardy thinks that her innate purity remains intact to the very last. It is only a certain outward purity that leaves her, right? It is only a certain outward purity, right? And it leaves her when she yields to Alec and allows her to embrace her soulless body for saving the family from destitute conditions and starvation, right? And the guardians, so-called guardians of public morality, should not attach a narrow and special meaning. Indeed, woman's virtue is man's own invention, right? To him, the word pure refers to something unbroken, unpolished, or perfect. This is why Thomas Hardy calls her almost a standard woman in the novel itself. We can call Tess a standard woman in the sense that purity is the spirit with a spiritual reference. We can call her a pure woman. She is pure even in morality of both of mind and the heart, right? And whatever the Victorian moralists call her, still, Tess is a pure woman. She is pure woman to all of us, and the majority of us are inclined to say that she is pure. She is pure in everything. She is pure in her intentions. She is pure in her life and in her nature as a whole. Whatever the Victorian moralist call, but Tess is pure for us, right? She is right when she says that once lost is always lost is not really true of chastity. She is not at all responsible for her reluctant affair of admitting Alec's advances for a few minutes. her parents forced her to go, and she also wants to earn money so that she can save her family from starvation, right? And when she yields to Alec for second time, she seems to be more corpse. She seems like a dead body, trifling with the devil to her end. At this time, she is not simply herself, right? When she yields to Alec for second time, she is not herself. Her mind is drugged, dead with weariness, pain, and despair. This is the condition. This is the circumstance that she has to surrender. And just as Alec is too late in making his proposal of marriage to her, Angel Claire is too late to returning to her. That is why I told that she ends up violated by one man and forsaken by another man, right? Alex is too late in his proposal, and Angel Claire is too late to return to her, right? And according to C.D. Lewis, the story of Tess embodies a heroic attempt to bring light to mankind. It is an attack on social conventions. So it embodies a heroic attempt to bring light to mankind, right? When Angel Claire goes abroad, he gets rid of the conventional morality. A fellow traveler impressed upon his mind that Tess is a pure woman and that he had been unjust to her, right? Angel Claire accepts her as a pure woman in the end when he weighs and considered all these things. And we come to the conclusion that Thomas Hardy is right in calling Tess a pure woman. The subtitle of the novel, A Pure Woman, stresses the essential purity of its heroine, right? Though she is fallen, she is to be judged not by her moral trouble, but by her moral intentions, her life, her nature as a whole. So friends, this is all about today's topic. I hope you like the content, and if you like it, please hit the like button, share and subscribe my channel. And if you're new to my channel, please hit the bell button so that you can get notifications for my upcoming videos. Thanks a lot for watching.